and takes me back down memory lane as well. But before I get into sharing bold and crazy equals breakthrough, I want to just share a little appetizer. I want to just stir your faith up a little bit this morning. And you know, when man attempts to do things to you, God needs to do very little to flatten it. God doesn't have to do much to sort problems out. You know, we think our problems are major and there's an issue and how's this going to be sorted out. And we remember when Jesus was on the cross, they took him and Joseph gave Jesus his tomb for Jesus to be buried in. And they rolled a big stone. Now, it's not a little stone. It's a groot rot, you know. They rolled in front of it. And then the Jewish leaders went to the Romans and said, listen, the disciple said he's going to be raised on the third day and they might come and steal the body. Can you put guards in front of it? And by that time, oh, Pilate had enough of them and he said, you go do it. And so they sealed the tomb. So it was sealed. And then they put a guard there, their guards in front of it. Okay. So here, Jesus is crucified. I want you just to picture for a minute that you were one of the disciples following Jesus. Yeah, he's dead. He's in a tomb. It's sealed and there are guards around it. I don't know about you. My heart would have sank a little bit. And I think, well, now what? It's over. But you see, with God, nothing is over until he says so, until he has the say. And so they secured the tomb, sealing the stone and setting the guard. Now, in Matthew 2, 1 to 6, it says, now after the Sabbath, near dawn of the first of the week, Mary Magdala and other Mary went to take a look at the tomb. And behold, there was a what? Great earthquake. For an angel, just let's stop there. Hello, hello. There's a great earthquake because an angel. How many angels is an? One. One angel comes and there's an earthquake. And rolled back the boulder and sat in it. You know, I love this. You know, one angel comes and he comes and lands on earth and there's an earthquake. And then he rolls the stone away and sits on it. Something they'd steal, you know, sealed and got there. And so often we think, oh, what's happening in my life and my circumstances and my situation? Listen, took one angel. Will you say one angel? And verse 3 says, his appearance was like lightning and his garments as white as snow. And those keeping guard, now you must remember, those keeping guard weren't ballet dancers or anything else. Those keeping guard were well-built soldiers, amen? And so they stand in there, and it says those keeping guard were so frightened, hulle so geskrik, at the sight of him that they were agitated and they trembled and became like dead men. They were out. And then the next verse says that But the angel said to the woman, do not be alarmed and frightened, for I know that you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. So even the woman were alarmed. Listen, we all sitting here and reading that story. I want to ask you something. And I think we'll just take one angel. If one angel lands here and the whole place shakes and he's like lightning, you won't be sitting like you're sitting. So don't be all skeinheilig here this morning. You will not be sitting here like you're sitting and looking at me like, so what? You'd also pass out, at least 50% of you, okay? The other 50% would run out. But it took one angel to do this. And his appearance is as lightning, and he says, don't be alarmed. And I love the Mark, in Mark 16, 5, it says, and entering the tomb, they saw a young man. Will you say a young man? Clothed in a long white robe, sitting on the right side. I want to tell you, ladies, you're going to have no problems with wrinkles in heaven. You won't need all the vanishing creams and the crinkle creams or whatever creams you use to try and get all the lines out. Because you know what? Everybody's going to look young then. Because when we raise, we transformed in the twinkling of an eye. Oh my gosh, and you're all going to be so beautiful. You're beautiful now, so I can imagine how beautiful you're going to be. Amen? So, you know, I just put that in. You ladies can relax, you know. But one angel caused an earthquake. One angel rolled the stone away, which had been sealed. And one angel scared the wits out of a guard that they fell down like dead men. Listen, what does it take for God to do your miracle? You know, when we look at our thing and we think, oh, what's it going to take? One angel. Amen. How's God going to solve this out? One word from God. Come on. How's this going to change? I don't know, but God makes a way where there's no way. Amen. He makes a highway where there's rubbish. Amen. So, you know, I want to just encourage you this morning. And so if you're in a situation that seems deadlock and at an end and closed in and you feel you're in this tomb, I've got good news for you. God doesn't need to do a lot to change it. Amen. You know, in the church, and I'm talking about, my kids are in their 40s, I'm talking about easy 40 years ago, most probably, we had a lot of extraditions coming down, and we had a lot of them in our church. And you know the stories they used to tell about angels. One actually wrote a book, and the one lady was testifying where it was her and her husband. They were elderly, and they saw the terrorists coming, and they got down on their knees and put their hands out, and they started praying and praying in the spirit and praising God and praying. And all of a sudden, these men took off and ran. But by that time, they'd notified the other farmers, because they used to have a system where they let each other know. And so some farmers were coming that way towards them. And these men were running, but they managed to catch one or two. And they said to them, "Why are you running away like that when you were right by the house?" And they said, "If you'd seen those huge men in white with swords as big as a human, you'd also run." Come on, church. I want to tell you something. Our pastor in Kempton Park, his wife was doing an outreach in one of the colored townships, and they had the flaps of the tent down so the breeze could come through, and suddenly they heard shots and people screaming that, and then she just said to everybody, "Come, let's get to the middle and pray in the spirit. We just pray. We don't know what's going on." And they had the flaps down, and they saw these men who had just committed an armed robbery. They saw these men running towards the tent, and suddenly they stopped and they ran around to the other side. And they stopped and then they ran away, but the police caught them. Now, pastor's wife went to the police. They said, could I ask them a question? And the policeman said, "Yes." And she said, "Why didn't you come into the tent?" He said, "What? Didn't you see the big wall of fire that came up and two big men on either side, white men with swords?" Come on, church. You know, this is the kingdom. Come on, give God praise, you know. Church, you can get excited about that. Yes. Amen. You really can, you know. Can we have a clap and a hallelujah? But you see, that's how the kingdom of God works. And we want to operate in the kingdom of the world, but that's how the kingdom of God operates. And we need to get a kingdom mentality. Amen. I walk and someone comes up to me with a gun. Well, I believe the angels are with me. Amen. Come on. And it took one angel to change that whole situation. And the testimonies we used to hear from them, from these ex-roadies. I want to tell you, there's no struggle too big for God. There's no problem too difficult. Amen. And despite the dark prospect, some of us look and go, "Oh, it's so black and it's so dark." Well, you know what? God's light and his life. Despite the gloomy predictions, listen, that tomb was sealed. But Jesus had the victory over death and over everything that Satan thought he'd done. Amen. Don't ever think Satan's got the upper hand in your situation, because that's a lie straight from him. You see, in Christ, there's no containment. Will you say no containment? That means nothing can contain God. Because, you know, yesterday in the prayer meeting, and a scripture came up, and someone prayed after that scripture to say, "God, forgive us for putting you in a box," and all that. And I'm going to bring that scripture in now. It wasn't in my notes, but it spoke so to me. And you know, sometimes we contain God. We put him in a box. This is all he can do. But sometimes we put ourselves in a box. Come on. This is all I'm at. But the resurrected power of Jesus is in you. So there should be no containment in your life. You should be speaking and believing for blessing and favor from God and increase from God. Come on. Amen. I mean, if ever there's a testimony of it, it's young. It's nearly 5 years. It is 5 years now. Hey, young? No, it's 5 years ago. Where he couldn't walk, talk, do anything, but he had faith. God can do it. Amen. I tell you what, we contain ourselves and we put God in a container. We think, oh, I don't know how he's going to do this. It's too big. It's such a big problem. You know what? When we focus on the problem, instead of the greatness of God, then our problem overrules our life. God's greatness is bigger than your problem. Can I have an amen? Amen. Can I have an amen? You see, as we read the scripture and it came up, and the scripture that came to mind was Ephesians 3, and Ephesians 3, 20 and 21. And it says, and I'm going to do it in the Amplified, which is really drawn out, but it's good. Now to him who by in consequence of the action of his power that is at work, where's his power at work? Sorry, where's his power at work? Within us. It's in us. Is able to carry out his purpose and do superabundantly, far over and above, all that we dare ask or think, infinitely beyond our highest prayers, desires, thoughts, hopes, or dreams. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations. You know what? I believe glory to Christ will come back in the church when we believe he can do immeasurably more than we can ever ask or dream of. Who believes that this morning? I said he can do more than you can ask or think of or dream of. He can do immeasurably more, but God, people, we got to have the faith of Abraham. We got to believe he will do it. Amen? And if we don't believe he'll do it, well, then there's no glory. Now, in the New King James, it says this. Now, to him is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Church, the power is in us, and he will work in us to do exceedingly abundantly more than we could ever think of. But you know what we do? We sit in our circumstance and, oh, you know, this is so hard, so difficult. Listen, the power's within you to change it. Amen. And God can only work when you start stepping out and believing. Amen. Come on, church. You know what? I don't know about you, but when I think that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly all that I ask or think or I could even dream of, you know what? I get excited. Can we give God a praise for that? Come on. It doesn't matter what you're going through now. God can do greater. But we've got to have the faith. We've got to believe. We're in the situation, but something better is coming. Amen. You see, never, and I think some of us don't even realize God's powers are at work within us. We think his power's got to come. No, it's at work within me. Never doubt God's mighty power in you. Amen. You need to get up in the morning and you know, you need to, do some virgin active gym. God's power's within me. Hallelujah. Superman, you got nothing on me. Come on. Come on. Batman, you defeated. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm stronger than Mr. Universe in the spiritual realm. Come on. Amen. And we need to see this. We don't see it. We are Christian and la la land. We are Christian. Hallelujah. No. He can do more than you can ever ask or think of a dream, but you've got to believe that power's within you to do it. So when you speak, something's going to happen. Amen. When you declare good stuff, it's going to happen. Listen, he will and can achieve more than your greatest request. Your most unbelievable dream, he'll exceed. And we need to believe that. That's the God we serve. Amen. Now, you see, I wanted to just whet your appetite a little bit. Because if we look at those scriptures and you see the picture we have there, that is someone breaking the sound barrier. And that person, the first person who did it, was bold and crazy. Because he was going and going. Many people had attempted and they turned back. But the first man to do it went. And you know what? They thought he was crazy. The control tower was saying, you need to turn back. You need to turn back. It sounded like everything in that plane was going to come off. It sounded like every bolt was rattling. And that whole plane could have just blown up. And the control tower is saying, come back. And he just decides, I might be crazy, but I'm going to see what's on the other side. And what happened when he got on the other side? Total peace. Total peace. Just bloody. You see, some of us, when the shake, rattle, and roll, you know what Elvis Presley is going on in your life? When the shake, rattle, and roll is going, you give up. No, no, keep going. Because God's going to get you when you are crazy enough to go through that thing. And since that first man went through the sound barrier, many have now. But it took one man to be crazy enough not to listen to the control tower. Amen. Sometimes we are listening to this control tower and we're listening to the little voice of the devil. Oh, you can't, you'll never, oh, this or this. You know what? Tell the control tower, I'm switching off. And that might seem crazy, but I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing. I'm going to keep trusting God. I'm going to keep praising. I'm going to keep believing he's going to do more than I could ever believe or dream of. And I bet you he will, because it's his word. Amen. Now, I want to show you a little video clip. It's a very cute one. But if we could just have a life. You were one, you could go ahead, tell them all I know now. Shout it from the rooftop, right in on the skyline. All we had is gold now. Tell them I was happy and my heart is broken. All my scars are open. Tell them what I hold. Isn't that awesome? He succeeded. Why? Because no one told him it was impossible. Yes. With Christians say, I don't know if that's possible. Do you think you'll ever do that? You know, we sometimes in our lives, as our parents and teachers say, that's impossible. Come on. I'd someone say it's impossible that you'll ever speak to people. Well, I wish they were alive today. I'd bring them here and show them. Listen. We listen to what people say is impossible. Nothing is too difficult for God. Nothing is impossible for God. If someone said to that little boy, and listen, we've done it to our kids, and you've had it done to you. No, no, you can't do that. You can't do that. Man, stop listening to the can't-dos and listening to God saying it's possible. I mean, I love that clip. I watch it often. I say, yes, Lord. Ek wil nie 'n hoender op die stoel sit nie, but you know what? There are things I'm going to do because it's possible through God. You don't have to be the same tomorrow if you believe God can change you. And he can do more than you believe. Amen. You can kick any habit. You can overcome anything in your life. You can sort it out. If you believe the power that's at work within me, God through that can do exceedingly abundantly more than my circumstances. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm going to tell you something now, and this isn't in my message. There's some of you sitting here on your blessed assurances thinking, oh, this is my situation. God has given you gifts and abilities, and you should be making money and creating things, but you're listening to what is impossible instead of what God says is possible. And some of you need to rise up and stop being... Yanya, you know what you are. You see... You've got to be a little crazy. Mark 2, 1 to 12 says this. And again, he, that's Jesus, entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. Immediately, many gathered together, so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door. Can you imagine? Jesus comes, and the place is packed. You can't get in. You can't even get through the door. And he preached the word to them. Verse 3. Then they came to him bringing a paralytic, a man who was paralyzed, who was carried by four men. And when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof. The one translation tells us how they uncovered it. They tore away the roof above Jesus' head. So they uncovered the roof where Jesus was. So when they'd broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying right down in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw, now I want you to listen to this. When Jesus saw what? The extent of their bold faith. Church, we've got to be bold. Your faith has got to be bold. You've got to step out where angels fear to tread sometimes. Come on. What did Jesus see? He didn't see the hole in the roof. He didn't see that he was covered in dust. Come on. Yeah, do you get that picture? The other guys, those roofs that day, you see a lot of the houses had stairs up the side to the roof. So yeah, these guys, they carried this man up to the roof and they scratched the roof away. You know, Jesus wasn't sitting there all clean. There's dust all over him. He didn't complain about the dust. Hello. He's not going to complain about the mess you make. Amen. He's going to give you credit for the bold, crazy faith you have. That was a crazy idea. We're going to tear the roof apart. And he saw the extent, would you say the extent of their bold faith? Church, I believe today we can talk about end times and listen about things on Israel. But what we need is bold faith. We need to stand in these days in bold faith. And I tell you what, when he saw the extent of the faith, he said to the paralytic man, and I want to add something there. It's not in the Bible. I'm not adding to the Bible. But to me, when Jesus saw the extent of their bold faith, he's saying, listen, your craziness in tearing that roof apart to get that man. And I want to tell you, these men were strategic. They didn't just go up on the roof and dig a hole. They went up and said, right, there's the door. Yeah, the people, Jesus is sitting here. This is where we've got to tear the roof off. Sometimes you've got to get a little bit, you know, use a little bit of this. And then they tore the roof off. And Jesus said, your sins are forgiven you. And then all the religious people were thinking, how can he say that? Who's he? And he knows them. And then he says, well, if it suits you, I'll say this. In verse 11, I say to you, arise, take up your bed and go to your house. Immediately he arose, took up the bed, went out in the presence of them all, so that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, we've never seen this. Now look, at first, you bring a paralytic, four of you. You want them to come to Jesus. How many times have we wanted to come to Jesus and there seems to be all sorts of obstacles? Just can't get there. Just not breakthrough. This isn't happening. That's not happening. You know what? They didn't give up. Amen. I mean, it seemed an impossible situation. Listen, you know what people are like, you know, like some of us are. The room is packed, Jesus is in the room, and they come and they say, excuse me, I want to get to you. Are you mad? Can't you see you can't get to the front? It's jam-packed. I was here before you anyway. Come on. That's people, you know, you. I don't care if he's parallel. I want to listen to Jesus, you know. I'm here. I was here before you. I've got this place. Come on. I'm sure they put up with that. And so they all went home feeling downcast and depressed. No. But we do. I can't get there. I don't know how I'm going to get there. So we go all depressed and nothing's ever going to happen in my life. Listen, not a chance. Nothing was going to stop these men. That's the boldness I'm talking about. I'm talking about bold enough to say, nothing's going to stop me entering God's promises. Nothing's going to stop me living in God's blessing. Come on. Amen. Some of you here this morning, I know there's some of you that need to say, Lord, I believe I am going to live in your blessing. Come on. I believe Abraham's blessings are mine. I'm going to have the faith Abraham had. Amen. No, they were unstoppable. They were extremely bold, Jesus said, and they went a little crazy. You see, if it was some of us, and I said, hey guys, let's tear the roof off. Oh, that's not very Christian. Oh, it's not a Christian thing to tear someone's roof off. No, can't do that. Maybe we should first pray about it. No, come on, let's get Christian easier. Amen. That's how some of us would be. You see, that's very inconsiderate. I mean, that's unorthodox. Jesus is going to get all dirty. We can't do that. We can't tear the roof down. Come on, I can see all your faces, and I can see the ones who are smiling. You're the ones who are saying, yo, that's me. I wouldn't want to do that. Come on. Not these guys. No obstacle was going to stop them. And that's how we would have bold faith. Doesn't matter what the obstacles are, nothing's going to stop me believing God's word, believing God's promises. Amen. And don't get all religious on me now and bring me this verse and that verse, because then go home and read your Bible. Amen. And go read the Ephesians. You see, it didn't happen in a conventional way. Amen. It didn't happen in the way we think church should be. Come on. Some have come into church meeting, this is how church must be. Wait, when the Lord messes it up, then we're unhappy. You see, to get breakthrough, they had to dare to be extremely bold enough and crazy to do the difficult, out of the ordinary, and costly thing. They knew they were going to have to repair that roof, but even that cost wouldn't stop them getting their friend to Jesus' feet, and that friend walked home with his mat under his arm. Amen. And you know what I think? We all know what Judas was like, and last week we spoke about him. He was a bit greedy in that. I think Jesus called Judas afterwards. Because you see, God will bless us if we have extreme crazy faith. I think he said, hey, Judas, get the roof fixed at our expense. Can you imagine Judas's faith? Huh? But we didn't do it. Judas, fix. I believe he did. And somehow in my heart, I just feel he did. You know what? But we want to count the cost. Oh, no, Jew. Now, if we tear the roof up, the four of us, it's going to cost us 20,000 rand. That's $5,000 each. We got, man, they didn't worry about the cost. They worried about nothing. The only thing that they worried was their friend getting to the feet of Jesus. And sometimes when we've got someone we want to get to the feet of Jesus, I want to tell you something. It might cost you. Might cost you not just time, but money. Come on. There's a man today that I knew and was in our church many, many years ago, and he's in the ministry today. You know what? I couldn't get through to him, but you know how I got through to him? And I'd say to my wife, my wife and I were always in agreement. I'd say, sweetie, it's not in our budget, but I need to take this man out for a meal because he will talk over a meal. And I took him out for a few meals I couldn't really afford. But you know what? Today, God's blessed me. And can I tell you what, today that man's in the ministry. Sometimes it does cost us. I spoke to someone yesterday, they're having issues with getting rent on a property of theirs. I said, Boki, who came and gave us that course, we knew Boki used to be a pastor in Hatfield. And then the craziest thing, he said, Lord, why? I've got a passion for the ministry, but it's not somehow breaking through. And the Lord said, because I've given you wisdom and knowledge in finances, your ministry is in finances. And him and his son go all over today, and they help people sort their finances out. Tish and I knew him when he was still a pastor at Hatfield. We went to his seminar when he came to Rustenburg. Let me tell you, he teaches his kids. His one daughter baked, and he said to her, what are you going to do with your baking? You can't just bake. What do you want to do? She said, I want to open up a shop. I want to tell you, while she was still at school, she had so many orders for wedding cakes, she couldn't keep up. When she matriculated, she had enough money to pay the rent 3 months for her own shop and open her own shop. We got to teach our kid. And his son, he taught him in property and buying and selling property in there. And he was in matric. They taught people. The mom and dad and the son. And so the son doesn't look, you know, as if he's still at school. And so the one day he realizes, because they used to personally go collect the rent and they talk to the people, find out how they are. Are you doing all right? Can we help you in any way? Do you know what? People don't want to move out their houses. And one day his son was a bit late to get home to get the car, so he just went on his bicycle. And the one lady said, oh, goodness me, a businessman like you riding on your bicycle. And he felt embarrassed. He said, yo, I just need the exercise. He said, Father, sorry, it's a lie. But in matric, he already was running a rental company, renting houses out, collecting rentals for people and getting commission. You don't have to wait till you're 93. Come on, break the barrier. Some of you need to break the cycle in your family's lives and get a life and start living and start earning and start thinking. And when this man was sharing that his rent wasn't coming, I said, you know what Boki does? If someone's battling, he'll go to Kum or somewhere. And he buys them, not an expensive, he buys them a book on finances and how to deal. And he'll say to them, look, I know you're battling, but I want to bless you. Here's a book. If you don't understand, find me. And do you know what? Within a few months, those people are out of their financials. So why? Why? Because he did the out of the ordinary. It cost him. Church, sometimes We want to pay our tithes and offerings, and then we think we've done our bit. Sometimes it costs. I want to tell you another story, and this isn't in the message, but it's, there's a man who's in business today, very successful in doing what he's doing. I saw him and his wife are in what I call a Rustenburg rut. Now, Rustenburg, we think this is the only world that exists, is Rustenburg, and the 6 coffee shops, and the this and the that and the more. And one day I said to my wife, you know what? And when I used to say, honey, you know what? She'd say, okay, it's going to cut our budget, hey? I'd say, yes. I said, we're going to take these people, we're going to book them in, and we're going to stay a night, and we're going to take them for the buffet at Mount Grace. I did it with someone else, Clive and Helen too, but that's another story. And you know what that man often says to me today? He said, you know what? I want to thank you for doing that for us, because that opened our eyes that we need to believe for bigger and better and greater. Sometimes you just need to go have coffee in a shop that's a little more expensive than you can afford. And just say, Lord, there's a bigger life out here. And I'm believing that for you, from you. Come on. Amen. He's able to do immeasurably more than that. You're so confused, man. God's a big God. Amen. And that you got for Mahala. But you see, they knew it would cost them, but I don't believe they paid for it. But they got their breakthrough. We need to get out, church. We need to get out of sitting and having whining prayers. Oh, Lord, I need deliverance. Oh, Lord, I want... No, no, God, I believe through me you're going to do immeasurably more than I can ever think and dream of. Amen. Come on. You know, we need to get some sound barrier breaking boldness in our lives with the Lord. I'm going to push through this. This thing's not going to stop me. Can you imagine when we won the rugby cup, Deanne and I, a few others were standing up eventually, and I'd say, how much time? I couldn't look. I thought, oh, Lord, how much time? The whistle must go now. We're winning. And I tell you, but they get in that scrum. When they get in that scrum, they don't get in. You see the Okies, the opposition. And you watch them. They have the pants up and they do everything, but you know, us Christians, there's opposition, achy breaky heart, I'm all shook up. No, man, get some boldness, be a little bit crazy, do something out of the ordinary. Come on, amen. You want breakthrough, do it. I was with a man the other day, and I was having coffee there. We took some of coffee, and I said to him, you know what I thought of? And he said, tell me, if it's a business idea, I'll do it. I thought, I like this man. And I told him, and you know what? They've changed things in their shop in 2 days. That was crazy for him, because that wasn't their intent. And it's paying off. You see, it took one angel. But the boldest and craziest thing was Jesus allowed himself to be crucified for us. An innocent man did nothing. Crazy. The crowds went crazy. And Jesus just went with that craziness. And he was bold enough to endure the cross for us. And then the devil thought he had him in the tomb, but it took one angel to sort that out. If Jesus and his resurrected power is in us, church, sometimes, and sorry about this, but we're so cotton-wooled in today's living, sometimes we're going to have to crucify our flesh. We've got to crucify ourselves. And we've got to say, I'm going to die to self, but I'm going to do what you want me to. I'm going to be bold enough to get up and preach or teach or do whatever. I'm going to be bold enough to believe you for better things. I'm going to be bold enough to believe you that I can change. Come on. I'm going to be bold enough that I don't have to live in grief for 10 years. Come on. Because he, through the power in us, can do immeasurably more than we can ever think or dream of. Do you believe that this morning? You see, we talk about kingdom. Well, I tell you what, when we start getting a kingdom mentality, we'll understand nothing's too hard for God. Come on. He can send an angel. He can change. He can dry up waters. He can send the waters. Come on. He can do whatever we believe in our hearts. He will do more. And so this morning, I want you to believe that. This morning, we're going to take communion. And I don't know how you in your heart come and take communion. I'm sure we all take it differently. I know some people come and remember the death of Jesus, and we need to. He said so. We need to remember what he's done for us. But I wonder how many of you will come this morning and say, Lord, this morning I'm going to be crazy enough and bold enough to receive everything that this covenant means to me. Kirsty brought that scripture up. I do not have a spirit of fear, but I have a spirit of power. Come on. And love, and sound mind, and self-discipline. I have my healing. I am able to do all things through this covenant. I'm be able to speak, and it's got to change. I shared with a prayer group that something happened to me in the week, and I was praying about it. I said, Lord, this has got to stop my body. And it's like the Lord said, well, when are you going to command it to stop? So I sat there and I said, Father, in Jesus' name, in the authority I have in Jesus, I command it stopped. You know what? It stopped. Come on, praise God. Sometimes we got to say, I command it in Jesus' name. I command my child's going to change in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on. Woo. That boss, he's going to love me in Jesus' name. He's not going to hate me. Come on. You see, a couple of weeks ago, I said that not this prayer meeting, the one before. I came home from the office and I was walking around the house, and it was late afternoon. Actually, it was quite late afternoon. And as I was walking, I was talking to the Lord, but I was actually being very bold. And I thought, Lover Shane, you've got a bit of a cheek, you know. But Lord, I'm going to be bold. I need to know some things. And I know this sounds crazy, God, but you know what? I want to know this, God. I want to know it. And you know what? Can we put the light off for a minute, Stephen? I walked into my, now before you put that slide up, I've been in that house about 30 years, plus minus. This has never happened before. I went in every afternoon after that to check. It hasn't happened since. It only happened once. I walked into the bathroom, and this was on the floor. It was like God saying, the rainbow was my covenant. I've got a covenant with you. You need to be bold enough to believe my covenant. And that came on the floor, and I sent it to the kids, and my daughter said, oh, Dad, that's awesome. You've got your own personal rainbow in your house. But that was through being a bit bold and a bit crazy. As I walked, and you know, I went back every afternoon to look for that thing. It's never happened before, and I've never seen it again. When I was bold enough and crazy enough to come before the Lord for some things, he put that, as I walked in my bathroom floor, he put it there. And that made me realize, God, I've got to believe the covenant I have in Christ. And I want you to come to the table this morning knowing that you have a covenant with the Son of God. You have all the power and all authority in his name. He's not going to change your circumstances unless you decide you're going to do it. And you start acting on it. Amen. He's not going to send a fluttering little angel and say, oh, sorry, my darling, come near, 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 near. He's going to look at the extent of your bold faith and your craziness to believe him. And so when that came on my floor, I every day since then, I walk back and I say, okay, God, it was just there that once. But it was that once when I got a little bit bold, which I thought, hey, you're right, no, Biki, you're wet, so, you know, yes, for be why, so, you know, you know. But he put that on my bathroom floor. You have a covenant. Are you going to believe it this morning? Some of us serve Jesus, but we don't believe this. We don't believe the resurrected power in our lives. And that's what I want you to do when you take communion this morning. Be bold. Be crazy. But Lord, every doesn't matter what you've done in your life. It doesn't matter how you feel about yourself. It doesn't matter how good you've been or how bad you've been. It doesn't matter anything. When you come and put your faith in the covenant he cut for you, it all changes. And I want you to receive communion. I'm going to ask Dave and Liza and Arthur and Imelda to come up to serve us. If us just can just take the wrapping off the stuff. But I want you to be bold enough. I just want you to say, everything that belongs to me, my freedom, everything is mine in Jesus' name. And so, Father, as we prepare our hearts to take this covenant meal, which Jesus, you said, do this in remembrance of me. We remember what you did for us. But it's through that covenant and through the blood you shed for us that our sins were washed away, Lord, that we became new creations, that we became citizens of the kingdom of heaven. And we sit here today, not as some down and out lost South African. Lord, we are citizens of the Most High God, sons and daughters. And everything in that covenant, Lord, peace, joy, healing, provision. Lord, we could go through every single thing, power and authority, everything we're going to receive this morning. And we want to glorify you for it and thank you for it. And so we do take it in remembrance. We're remembering that you counted the poor joy to go to that cross because you knew what would be ours after the lamb was slain. And I pray today we will receive it in faith in Jesus' mighty name, that you will receive the honor and glory through our lives as we live a covenant life in and through Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. So we receive it with grateful hearts this morning, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask them just to serve. And and when you're ready, you just partake of it. You just partake when you're ready.